welcome to today's class on English language. And on today's class, we are going to be treating antonyms. Antonyms are words we need to understand what they mean. And by the end of this class, the specific objectives include ability to define antonyms, ability to identify the different types of antonyms with word examples, ability to identify the various prefixes that lead to the derivation of antonyms, and lastly, ability to identify the opposite of words through contextual usage. What is an antonym? An antonym is a word that has contrasting or opposite meaning to another word. They don't mean the same thing. When you say one thing, another thing will come as another meaning from it. Opposite, they are not together. Like when I say tall, and you know that the opposite of tall is short. So antonyms are words that have contrasting or opposite meaning to another word, directly or indirectly. What do we mean by directly or indirectly? Sometimes you can easily identify these words without any stress of the meaning. And some other times, you will need to understand how they are used in a sentence. That is what we say, contextual usage. And from that contextual usage, you can get the opposite in meaning. And antonyms comes from a Greek language. Two words came out from the Greek language, anti and onym. Anti simply means opposite, and onym simply means name. So when we say antonym simply means opposite name. That is the meaning in the Greek. And that is why we gave us the meaning that it is a word that has contrasting or opposite meaning to another word. Now we want to look at the types of antonym. First, we have the complementary antonym. And what is the meaning of this complementary antonym? These are antonyms that have no middle ground. As in, you don't have any middle ground. One mustn't exist for another one to exist. It's just there that when you have this word, there should be another word that comes as the opposite. There is no middle word, no middle ground, no relationship. Now, we have boy, and we know that the opposite of boy is girl, off, on, night, day, entrance, exit, exterior, interior, true, false, dead, alive, push, pull, pass, fail. This is what we call complementary antonym. And now we have another type, which is the relational antonyms. These are similar to complementary antonyms, except that both must exist. The only difference here is that both must exist. They are just like the complementary antonym, but their difference is that if there is this, then there must be another one. For instance, if I say I am a wife, that means I must have a husband. If I say I am a master, that means I must have a servant. If I say I'm a teacher, that means there must be students or pupils. So you see, one must exist for another one to exist. That is why we call it relational antonyms. For instance, we have above, below, doctor, patient, husband, wife, servant, master, borrow, lend. You cannot have an issue of borrowing if there is not a case of lending. Give, receive, predator, prey. You know the meaning of predator and prey. Someone that's an animal that seeks out to devour another, and the prey is the one that is being devoured. Buy, sell, instructor, pupil. This is what we call relational antonym. If you notice these examples, one must exist for another one to exist. Then the third type of antonym we have is graded antonym. Now, what do we mean by graded antonyms? These antonyms deal with levels of comparison, and they can be two words on a scale. They deal with levels of comparison. One is seen higher or lower than the other. And another thing I want us to understand about graded antonyms are they are relative terms. What do we mean by relative terms? It depends on your own perspective, the way you see it. If I see this ball as white, someone else might come and see it as black. So the way you see something. Or if I see this pen as dirty, somebody might come and see it as being neat. This is what we call relative. So it depends on how you see it. For instance, you see someone and you say that person is young. Another person might see that person and say the person is elderly. Hard, easy or soft. Happy, sad or wistful. Wise, foolish. Fat, slim. Warm, cool. Early, late. Fast, slow. Dark, pale or bright. So you notice that from the examples, they depend on your own perspective. That is why we call them relative terms. And that's why we call them graded antonyms, depending on how you grade it. So that is the what we have for now. But the next thing we're going into is how prefixes are added. Prefixes that are added to antonyms. All right, the next topic is what? Add a prefix to create an antonym. We need to see the various prefixes which can be added to a word, and that word becomes the opposite of another word. And notice, we add prefix to a word. For instance, I bring out a word and add a prefix to it. That prefix I add to it makes it opposite in meaning to that word. Now we have like how many of them? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are not all, but I just chose some popular prefixes for us to look at. Now we have the prefix this. When we add the prefix this to some words, those prefixes makes that word opposite of that word. For instance, we have agree. If I add prefix to this, to agree, it makes it opposite of agree. For instance, agree, disagree, appear, disappear, believe, disbelieve, honest, dishonest. You see, in these words, these are same words, they are same words, but the only difference here is the prefixes added to them. Remember that prefixes are words you add before a main word. They are words to add before a base word. So this is what we call prefixes. Then the second prefix is in. And when we add in to some of the words, it makes them opposite of that word. Now we have tolerant, intolerant, decent, indecent, excusable, inexcusable. The next one is miss, M-I-S. We have behave, misbehave. Interpret, misinterpret. Lead, mislead. Trust, mistrust. Then we have the third one, U-N. And we have likely, unlikely. Able, unable. Fortunate, unfortunate. Forgiven, unforgiven. Now we have the last, which I listed here. Remember I told you that these are not all, I just chose some popular words. None, entity, non-entity, conformist, non-conformist, payment, non-payment, sense, nonsense. So we see that these are prefixes added to words and making them opposite of that same word that is being added to it. All right, for our notes today, we need to understand that there are not many words that are exactly opposite in meaning to other words. Some words are not exactly opposite in meaning to other words. What do you now do? You look at the contextual usage. And that is why we say in exam, you see something like nearly opposite in meaning. Because sometimes you may not find a particular word that is directly opposite in meaning to that word. What you now do is you look out for words that are nearly opposite in meaning to it. And sometimes you may not have a dictionary to find out the meaning of a word before knowing the opposite. So what do you do in a situation like this? All you need to do is what? Look at the contextual usage. How is the word used in the sentence? That way you can easily identify the opposite in meaning. And for an advice, I will ask you children to always equip yourself with reading novels at this period that we are staying at home to learn. Read novels often, because when you read novels often, you'll be increasing and equipping your vocabulary. In such a way, if you see any word, whether used in context or not, you can easily know the opposite in meaning if you are asked. With this, I say thank you. And you know how we always do it. Upon the day that my video is being sent to you, that is the same day I will send my assignment. And you know how we do it? I will equally send and tell you when to start submitting your assignment. Have a nice day, my students. Bye.